Thank you, Chairman Corker and Ranking Member Cardin, for both convening this hearing and for your persistence, your voice, your engagement of both of you in fighting human trafficking and fighting to end human slavery, and for the passion and engagement you bring to making sure that we don't just hold hearings on the deplorable conditions of the victims of sexual abuse and violence around the world, but that we actually do something and get something done. In this particular instance today, we're talking about UN peacekeeping, and I want to thank all of our witnesses for your testimony today, of both panels, but especially Ambassador Coleman, who I know is working hard to try and institute real reforms in the UN to make it a more effective institution. I just last week went to UN headquarters in New York and met with the UN Undersecretary General for Peacekeeping Operations, Hervé Ladsous, and was struck by the daunting challenges that peacekeepers face in the 21st century, by the number of countries where we've got UN peacekeepers deployed, and by the possibilities of peacekeeping in terms of protecting fragile countries from falling into being failed states. And I have strongly supported UN peacekeeping efforts in terms of appropriation support and view it as a cost-effective and a positive way for us to not just keep peace but build peace. But the allegations that have been made, not just in Carr, but Ambassador Coleman, as you've outlined, across dozens of different UN missions across decades now, are simply shocking and unacceptable. And it is the United States that is footing most of the bill for most of the peacekeepers who are committing these atrocities against men and women and children. And if the very people who we are funding, training, equipping, supporting to be peacekeepers can't be trusted to keep the peace and instead are committing crimes, then our support for UN peacekeeping is at risk of doing more harm than good. So I think we all agree we have to act, not just listen, not just take notes, but act to bring an end to sexual exploitation and abuse on a wide scale by UN peacekeepers. But simply providing peacekeepers and police doesn't fulfill a member state's obligation for the UN community of nations. It is the responsibility of member states to select and train and oversee appropriate units. And it is a struggle, as the chairman was just recognizing, many of the peacekeeping contributing countries are deploying peacekeepers, at least in the countries that I've traveled to with Senator Isaacson, in part in order to get their troops paid. We are not attracting the best and most capable and most trained peacekeeping forces from around the world, and we need to strengthen that. But before we make progress in that, I think we first have to institute meaningful accountability for nations and their peacekeepers who commit these kinds of crimes. So I look forward to exploring together ways this committee can help Ambassador Power and her team at the UN push for accountability that is meaningful and that can work together to end these crimes and to change peacekeepers from perpetrators of violence to protectors against violence. If I would, Ambassador, just tell me what peacekeeper training methods have proven most effective so far. In fact, I'd like all members of the panel, forgive me, to answer this question if you could. What's been successful in terms of training to reduce what Senator Isaacson, I think, correctly recognized is the training, whether intentional or by experience, of many of the troop-contributing countries that sexual violence is being used as a weapon of war? What is the training that is most effective at preventing that, and what can we do to strengthen that training in combination with accountability, if you would, in order, please?
Thank you. Well, I will allow General Rothstein to answer this specific training question, but if you would allow me just to say, I want to reiterate a point that General Rothstein made earlier, which is this is not fundamentally about a training issue. I mean, there is no training that is going to guarantee that this problem won't occur. And when you look at the troops that have committed these abuses, some of them are among the best trained troops in the world. And we know that they have explicit components of sexual exploitation and abuse prevention in their training methods. So ultimately, I come back to this as an accountability issue. There is no troop contributing country that is immune from these types of abuses. It's how they deal with them and how they deal with it in a fulsome way that provides prevention going forward. And
then before we turn to the training question, since we've got you, Ambassador Coleman, on this, how effective is naming and shaming, since a number of the countries involved and implicated are close allies of ours who have troops that are trained and perform at the highest level. Then we'll talk about training for those who lack operational excellence or efficiency. You're right. I think accountability matters first before training. How effective is the naming and shaming that we are advocating and that we may work together to strengthen?
Well, thank you, Senator. And I like to avoid the phrase naming and shaming because I see no shame in being named. The shame is in not following through with accountability. I think it really is a watershed for us to be able to identify the countries and then to be able to follow up directly with them and not tolerate, not allow the passivity that has existed, the sweeping under the carpet that has existed, frankly, the lack of accountability, and to not allow it anymore. And Senator Isaacson earlier talked about having a big stick, and Mr. Chairman, you've talked about money. The money is a big stick, and to be able to say that you will not participate in peacekeeping any longer if you do not hold your troops accountable, if you do not report back to the Security Council, to the Secretary General on what you're doing, if you do not prosecute these allegations in a full and sufficient way. I mean, that is ultimately the UN's big stick, because the troop-contributing countries will retain jurisdiction over their troops. They can either choose to have a full, appropriate response or not. And if they don't, then frankly, they should no longer be part of peacekeeping.
I couldn't agree more. And as someone who has fought for the appropriations for peacekeeping, I'm ashamed that we've been supporting peacekeepers who are doing horrible things and want to make sure that working together, we find a mechanism for accountability that is appropriate and that uses the fact that we are one of the principal contributors to peacekeeping support to ensure that this comes to an end. General, what sorts of engagements, accountability, are most effective for troops, whether training or prosecution or otherwise?
Thank you for that. I'd like to start by really echoing what Ambassador Coleman said.
Thank you very much. I apologize. So let me start by echoing what Ambassador Coleman said. My perspective is that training is absolutely necessary, but make no mistake, I do not think it is sufficient. This is a problem that is much broader than training. And I believe we have to train. Through the training we provide through our security assistance, we think it is pretty good. And as far as best practices of that, what we work to do in our training, we start in the classroom, we move to scenarios, we move to including in exercises, and we also focus very much on unit leadership. And we draw on the best of breed. We work very closely with the United Nations to find the best practices that have worked well. We make sure they understand their policy. But all of that, no matter how well you do it, will not be sufficient. And so I would echo what Ambassador Coleman said, we have to focus on accountability. And I'd also echo that we have to focus on how the country is falling up. Just because you have a rotten individual or maybe even a rotten unit does not mean you necessarily want to disengage from the whole country. Because as we remain focused on future outcomes, if that country is still going to deploy to UN peacekeeping and we want to affect it for the better, then we probably want to be involved in their training and help make it better and not walk away and let it deteriorate.
Well,
those are the
you.
Difficult decisions we have.
I'm past my time. I just want to say I'm looking forward to the second panel where we're going to hear, frankly, about UN suppression of whistleblowers and the real likelihood that these abuses are far more widespread than has so far been reported. Thank you for your testimony and your hard work on this topic.